Let us study a lesson for Standard 10 Biology, Absorption, the processes involved. This is part 1 of the lesson. Now, in the half of this lesson will be done in part 2. So, let's study the functions of the roots. From when you are little, you know that the plant, you can see the part which is underground, which is under the soil is the root. It plays an important role. So, these are the things that the plant performs for the roots perform for the plants. Let's see. It fixes the plant to the soil. You know, roots spread underneath, they make the plant stable, they fix it to the soil. Absorption of water and minerals. That means all the processes that happen inside the body of the plant, most important process, photosynthesis, which produces food for the entire living world, comes from plants. So, absorption of water and minerals, if this process was not happening, there would have been no photosynthesis, no preparation of food, and all the other organisms down the food chain would have not been, or not existed in fact. Then, it conducts absorbed water and minerals through its tissues. As it is absorbed in, it goes through the tissues, passes through the tissues of the roots, and then it goes upwards later through the stem. So, there are other functions of the roots also, like storage of food and other things. But here mainly we are studying absorption. Hence we are studying the functions of the root like this. Now, let us see what are the processes that happen in the plant for which it requires water. So, these are the processes. For what water is required? Why does a plant require water? Require water. For what? For photosynthesis, of course. Photosynthesis cannot happen in the absence of water. Transpiration will not happen, then there will be no cooling. Cooling of the plant. Also, because of this transpiration, I'll teach you in further lessons, the water is able to rise in the stem. Translocation of food. Food. It will happen in a medium water. Then stiffness of the plant. The plant is fixed to a place. If it is flaccid, if it is, you know, droopy, it will not survive. So, these are the reasons why the plants require water. So, stiffness, again, the cells of the plant require to be turgid. Now, how are the minerals available to the plant? They are available in the form of salts. They can be nitrates, they can be sulfates, they can be phosphates, or in the form of ions, like potassium, calcium, magnesium, chlorine. Now, these are required by the cell organelles for various processes. They are also required for producing of enzymes, chemicals in the body of the plant. So, minerals are required which the root provides, or the root carries through by this process of absorption of, with the water, as the water rises, goes into the root, these minerals and other salts are also sent into the plant so that the plant can perform all these functions like photosynthesis, preparation of food, transpiration, rising of water inside the stem, reaching the upper parts, also for cooling the plant, then translocation of food, then providing rigidity. Rigidity happens, stiffness happens when there is water in the cells of the plant. Let us look now at the characteristics of roots that help it to absorb water. The root has made itself a special structures here, and its ability to absorb water is enhanced because of the structural things that have happened to the root. Now let us look at this. What is this? This is a root hair. Root hair. Now what is a root hair? It is an extension like this of the epidermis here, to form the root hair. It's an extension of these cells. Now see, first characteristics that enable the root to help it to absorb water is its branching nature. If you look at the roots, they will be highly branched, very, very branched. If it was just a single thing, so because of being branched, it's able to reach, it increases its surface area. If it was just one long process-like thing, it would have not reached out. Now, there are soil particles here. There is water here in the middle of the soil everywhere. So, because of its huge branching nature, it has a large surface area. So, let us write down this point. Large surface area. Large surface area. Why? Because of its branching nature. branching. I'm writing branching here. So even these things, even these thinner roots, they'll have many root hair. See, root hair here, everywhere. So even a small plant can have, where if you put all the length together, you'll find it to be very long, even in a small plant. So it's widely branched, so because of this branching nature. Now look at this part. So here you have seen a little enlarged diagram of the root. You can see the root hair here. This is the vacuum because it's a plant cell. Now look at this wall. This is the cell wall. Let's say this is the cell wall. Now what could be the feature? It is thin and it is freely permeable. So it allows water to move inside. Freely permeable. Permeable. So it allows the water to move inside along with the minerals to move inside. Now even the cell membrane, this is the cell membrane here. Let me mark it here. This cell membrane, again it is thin, but it is selectively permeable. So what happens? The larger molecules cannot go inside, but the water can easily go inside. So it is selectively permeable. Permeable. So these main features, they enable the root to perform its function of absorption easily. What could be the main ones? Let me repeat again. The large surface area, the branching nature of the roots, the cell wall, which is freely permeable, allows movement of water and other things into the root easily. Then the root hairs, they are extending all over and they are spreading far, branching far. Then we have the cell membrane of the roots. The cells of the root, the cell membrane, which is selectively permeable. The larger particles are left, cannot go inside. So, but the water and other things can go inside. I have mentioned a word here, phenomena. Now, what are the phenomena? I have listed down a few of the phenomena. Now, let's see. There are three things happening when water is going into the body of the plant. First, the root hair are absorbing water and minerals dissolved in them from the soil. Then via the tissue, suppose I say this is the root of a plant. I'm just taking one. I'm not showing its branching nature here. So if this is cut from here, okay, suppose I'm saying this is the root here. The water will have to move through these tissues to reach the xylem. You know, from here onwards is the xylem. So the water will have to move here in this direction. Now that means water has to move and minerals through this, through the thickness of the root, and afterwards upward conduction of water to reach the upper parts of the plant. So, these are the main phenomena which help it, all these phenomena together, they help the process, these three things. What are the three things? Water being absorbed via the root hair into the plant, passing through the thickness of the root, and then upward condition, a conduction of water. Now, let us see, one by one, we are going to study these. What are these? Let's read them out. Imbibition, diffusion, osmosis, active transport, turgidity and flaccidity. Let us study the first phenomena, imbibition here. What is this? It says that living or dead cells of a plant, they can be in a dry state or they can be in a semi-dry state, they absorb water by surface attraction. Now, if you notice during the monsoons, the doors get wooden frames, doors and windows, they get warped. That means they are a little bigger in size, they become bigger, it's difficult to close them, open them. Why do they get warped? Because there is wood in them. So the wood, what does it have? The wood has cellulose. Wood has cellulose in it. What will happen? This cellulose has an affinity for water. You can say affinity or love for water. You can say like that also. So this cellulose has an affinity for water. It attracts the molecules of water. Thereby, these wooden frames, they get warped. This can be a give reason question. Also see, seeds, you keep them in water, they have, what do the seeds have? They have proteins in them. Proteins. Now, this proteins, this protein has a affinity for water. So, we can see that it has a, let's say, protein, it has a love for water, an affinity for water. Hence, when we keep a, suppose we take a seed and we soak it, you can first see it will become fully swollen up, and after a while you'll see that this seed coat will rupture. So why does this happen? Because the seeds have a affinity for water, they attract water, hence this imbibition happens. Now what could be the significance of this process? What happens? This process is very important to plants, because when the seeds are germinating, in germination the seed coat has to break, otherwise there would be no germination. Also, again, it is a process which is helping in absorption of water. When we studied imbibition, we studied that it happens because of affinity of certain substances towards water. That means these substances are hydrophilic substances. So that is just a process which attracts water molecules towards itself due to surface attraction. Now let's study the next process, diffusion. What is diffusion? I have written a definition here for you. Free movement of molecules of a substance from the region of high concentration to the region of their lower concentration when in direct contact. Now let us study this in detail. When I'm saying substance here, it means it can be a solute, it can be a solvent, or it can be a gas. So diffusion happens in all mediums. Now let's see another word that I have mentioned here, direct contact. That means there is no membrane between them, there's nothing separating between them. Direct contact, we can use another word also, like fully permeable. So what is moving? The molecules are moving, nothing is stopping them, a free movement. Molecules are moving from a region of their high concentration to a region of their low concentration when in direct contact. Now let's see, I'm drawing a simple diagram for you here. Let's say this is a cup of water here, or a glass of water. Now I place a crystal here. It can be copper sulfate, it can be potassium permanganate, it can be sugar. So let us say anything. Let us say copper sulfate. Copper sulfate. Now what will happen after a while? This is water, it's filled with water here, everywhere. The concentration of the copper sulfate is here in the crystal. That means this is the region of high concentration of the copper sulfate. After a while, the molecules of this copper sulfate will start dispersing here, like they'll move over here. I'm drawing them as dots, okay? So they will move and they'll start diffusing the water. You can see the color changing. This will continue to happen till these molecules completely spread out inside this water, and this becomes a homogeneous solution. So, and direct contact means this copper sulfate is completely in direct contact with the water. There's nothing separating them from each other. It will go on spreading like this. Now, how to increase the speed of diffusion? If you take a spoon and you stir it, the speed of diffusion will increase and time taken for this process to happen will reduce. Now, how would diffusion be useful to plants? Now, if you look at the stomata, the carbon dioxide from inside the plant is diffusing out of the plant via the stomata. Oxygen from the air is also diffusing into the plant. So, this is diffusion. Remember these keywords, direct contact. Also remember, from a region, molecules are moving from a region of high concentration to a region of their low concentration. Now see, let us study the next phenomena, osmosis. A short definition is mentioned here for you all. Movement of solvent molecules. Understand these words, solvent. Suppose I have a solution of sugar and water. What would be the solvent in that? And what would be the solute? The solute would be sugar and the solvent would be water. Solvent molecules across a semi-permeable membrane. Now here, this word semi-permeable membrane is a key here. I'll explain it to you now. From a solution having a high concentration of solvent molecules to a solution having low concentration of solvent molecules. Now when I say semi-permeable membrane, what do I mean by this? Semi-permeable membrane, you can be asked a question, define semi-permeable membrane. So it can be a natural or it can be an artificial membrane. And what would be the speciality of this membrane? It would allow only certain molecules to pass through it. So it's not allowing everything to pass through it. It's only certain molecules in a solution can pass through it. If you're asked to give an example of semipermeable membrane, you can say parchment paper or cellophane paper, goat's bladder, now egg membrane. These are all examples of semipermeable membrane. A muslin cloth can't be a semipermeable membrane. A rubber sheet or a plastic sheet cannot be a semipermeable membrane. Only the ones that I have mentioned, like parchment paper, goat's bladder, sheep's bladder, then your cellophane paper, and you can also see the egg membrane. What is happening in osmosis? Look back at diffusion. The molecules of a substance were moving from their higher concentration to their lower concentration, and there was direct contact between them. But here there's a semi-permeable membrane. Look at the structure drawn for you all. This is the semi-permeable membrane. This one, semi-permeable membrane. These are two solutions. They are separate from each other by a semi-permeable membrane. Now, what is happening? I have drawn for you all symbols over there. These are molecules of the solute and these are molecules of the solvent. Now, you can see in this B part of this apparatus, you can see B here, you can see the solvent molecules are highly concentrated here while they are lesser here this side. So, what will these solvent molecules do? From their area of high concentration, they are moving, see, from a solution. This is a solution having high concentration of solvent molecules. They'll move through this and they'll come off this side. Through the semi-permeable membrane, they are moving and they are coming this side. So, having a low concentration. See, here there was high concentration of solute. Solute, remember. Suppose I say this is a sugar solution and this is a pure water solution. Sugar solution means sugar dissolved in water here. So what is the solute here? The solute is the sugar and the solvent is the water. So there's lesser number of water molecules here. And this side we have water. So the solvent is moving through the semi-permeable membrane from its region of high concentration to its region of lower concentration, lesser molecules are here. Until when this will happen? Till the concentrations become equal. So remember the semi-permeable membrane and learn the names of various semi-permeable membrane. Understand this, that in osmosis, here we have, if you have to compare it with diffusion, these solutions are separated by a semi-permeable membrane, and that the solvent is moving from its region of high concentration to its region of lower concentration. Now let us see, here I have drawn for you an osmoscope. Osmoscope. Now if someone asks you, define osmoscope, what are you going to say? It's an apparatus used to demonstrate this process of osmosis. Now what has been taken here? This is a raw potato. Raw potato. It has been cut with a cavity here in the middle. And it has been kept in a dish, like half, till half the level of the potato. It has been kept in the dish, which is containing water. And inside this pit, 25% sucrose solution. So if you look at it sideways, suppose this is the potato. It has been cut like this. Inside here is the sugar solution. And naturally, it has been placed in water all over here, in a dish. So like this it looks. Now, two levels have been marked. Level 1 in the beginning when we started the experiment. After a while you'll see the level inside here, inside the osmoscope, water level, it rises. Why it rises? Why does it rise? Because the water, which is the solvent here, the molecules have gone in through this potato semi-permeable membrane and they have, the level inside has gone up. This is here inside the solute. The solute is here inside, 25% sugar solution. More molecules of the solute are there and outside the solvent more molecules are there. So the solvent molecules are more concentrated on the outside. Hence they have moved inside. So this is a potato osmoscope. Osmoscope is an apparatus used to demonstrate. This we have made out of a potato osmoscope. Now what happens? Now you can see clearly. You can also reverse and try. That you can put the sugar solution outside and the water inside. You can try this in many ways. So this is a good way. Now a question rises. Suppose we don't take a raw potato and we boil the potato and afterwards make a cavity in it and make a potato osmoscope out of it. In that case, there will be no osmosis. Why would there be no osmosis? Because the cells of this potato would have lost their permeable nature. Hence, in a boiled potato, there would be no osmosis. But diffusion would continue. So, learn about the potato osmoscope. Try it also if at home if you can. Now, here is a simple diagram of a thistle funnel. Thistle funnel experiment. Now, why are we using this experiment? We are using it to understand osmosis. See what we have put out here. This is a thistle funnel. This is a beaker containing water in it. And look at the mouth of the thistle funnel. It has been covered by a cellophane paper. Again, I told you, cellophane paper. What it does? It is a semi-permeable membrane. Cellophane paper. This is your thistle funnel. So inside the thistle funnel, we have, let us say, 25% sucrose solution. And here we have water. This is just water. Alright. Now let's see what will happen. Now suppose this is the initial level. I'll write IL here. It means initial level. Initial level of the solution inside. Now if we set up this experiment and we leave it for a while, you'll see after a few hours, you'll see that the level of the water or the solution inside, 25% sucrose, has increased. It has gone up to another level. Till here somewhere. It has gone up. So the level has increased. Why did this happen? Because here the cellophane paper has acted as a semi-permeable membrane. It has allowed the water molecules to enter inside via this semi-permeable membrane. Hence the level of this solution inside the thistle funnel has gone up. Thereby, we can say that osmosis has happened here. Water is the solvent, molecules entered via the cellophane paper. This is a semi-permeable membrane and thereby increased. Now, we can also set up a control experiment for this. Like we put water inside. Control is for what? Control is meant to compare whether our results in both cases. Now see, we could have taken pure water inside and pure water outside. What would happen? That there is water inside, there is water outside. So, what would happen? It would not show any rise in the level of water inside the thistle funnel. Because then there would have been no movement of the, because the concentrations are the same. No movement of solvent molecules. Hence the concentration would have remained same. And there would have been no rise in the level. That is one thing. Now, if you reverse it, like suppose you say inside we'll put pure water. Can you guess what would have happened? Inside pure water, outside we would have had sucrose solution. Then what would have happened? The water from inside would have come outside. The solvent molecules would have come outside. Now, in this first case, if you want, when you try this experiment, you will note that when we have kept the sucrose solution inside, you taste this water outside, the water that is outside. You'll see that this water has not changed. It's because the water is, though it is in, because of the semi-permeable membrane is separating them, but this water would remain, it taste would not change. So that means the sugar molecules are not able to come out. It's only this solvent molecules which are entering in. So this is the initial level, this is the final level. So in the reverse case, what would have happened? The level would have fallen. In that case, where we are putting the 25% sucrose solution outside and the water inside the thistle funnel. So what do we derive from this experiment? It shows us that the water molecules have passed through the semi-permeable membrane and moved from their region of high concentration to the region of low concentration. Thereby saying that osmosis has happened. All kinds of combinations can be tried. So the solution concentration can be outside, it can be more, inside less. So all kinds of combination, it always proves the same thing, that the solvent molecules are moving from their region of high concentration to their region of low concentration, and that the cellophane paper is acting as a, or any other parchment paper or goat's bladder, egg membrane is acting as a semi-permeable membrane. Now see, we have done this thistle funnel experiment here. Now the question would arise, now will this continue, the osmosis process will continue, and to what extent would it continue? If something is kept, two solutions of different concentration are kept in separated by semi-permeable membrane. So ideally what we would think that, okay, the osmosis will continue and continue forever. But till both become equal, so it would, but after a while, when this happens here, when the column is rising here, because of the height and the weight of the column, the osmosis would gradually become, the process would become slower and slower. That is one thing. Now, if we have an arrangement like this, like we have put a piston here, okay, now the water molecules are trying to enter inside, okay, because their concentration of the water molecules is high outside. So the molecules are entering through this semi-permeable membrane and going inside the sugar sucrose solution. Now, if we have some arrangements like putting this piston here, every time the level rises, we push the piston down, we apply pressure on it. Then what would happen? We can use this piston here to nullify the effects of this osmosis. So what would happen? So then a question would come, how much pressure? What is the minimum pressure? Osmotic pressure. So the question, when you are asked to define osmotic pressure, you must understand that the minimum pressure that must be exerted to prevent what? The passage of pure solvent, which is water in this case, into the solution is this 25% sucrose solution, into the solution when the two are separated by a semi-permeable membrane, which is cellophane paper here. So the amount, this can be calculated, this can be found out, how much pressure is required in this case. So that would be your osmotic pressure. It would also say that osmotic pressure is the pressure required to nullify osmosis. That amount of pressure, that minimum amount of pressure which is required to nullify this process of osmosis. Now let's see, we come across these terms often when we study osmosis. Endosmosis, exosmosis. Now, we can also say, okay, two ways of osmosis or two kinds also if you want. See, what is the meaning of the word osmo? Osmo means push. Endo means towards inward. Inward. Exo means outward. So the name itself explains itself. Outward movement. Who's moving outward here? The solvent molecules. Movement of the solvent molecules. It's moving out. And here, outward movement of the solvent molecules. Moving out. Through what? Through a semi-permeable membrane. So, it is again moving out through a semi-permeable membrane. Now, let's see. Here's an example. We took some raisins and we put them in water. Water molecules are more outside. Inside, they are dry raisins. So, there is no water molecule. So, what will the water molecules do? They will move inside. They will go inside. Water. H2O is moving inside. What is this? What is this again? It can be. It is called endosmosis. Movement is happening of the solvent molecules towards the inside. After a while, what will happen? These will become nice and round and swollen. See, will become swollen up. Why? Because they have, the water molecule has moved inside. Now, if we take this thing, this swollen raisin, and we put it in a very, very concentrated sugar solution, they'll again shrivel up. Then that means the water molecules have moved outward. So, understand the difference between the endosmosis and exosmosis. The names themselves are self-explanatory.